morning and welcome back to Outlook Portland. I'm your host, David Bragg, and my guests this morning are from Chamber Music Northwest, David Schifrin and Jennifer Fracci. We've been talking about rehearsals. How do you get something ready for the stage? But I understand people in Portland are allowed to see some of the creative process.
Yeah, we open one of our rehearsals each week to the public free of charge. And every Wednesday morning during our five-week season, at 11 o'clock at Reed College, Call Auditorium. Anybody who wants to come and sit and watch us hash out how to interpret Beethoven or Brahms or Bach is welcome to come for that hour Wednesday morning at 11. And I think it's most interesting to come for those open rehearsals and then come to the performance and see how many of the ideas that have been discussed in the rehearsal find their way into the performance.
Well, we've been talking about how do you interpret classical composers who've been dead 200 or 300 years, and probably they're not going to give you much argument about how you interpret their work. But David, you, Chamber Music Northwest here in Portland and some of the other festivals commissions a lot of new work as well. It's a little riskier maybe on the audience side. But how does it affect the creative process if you have the composer actually in the room while you're playing his or her work?
Well, in some ways it's very difficult because you can't fake anything because the person
who
wrote it is right there. But on the other hand, you don't have to guess. Should this be louder? Should this be softer? Should this be faster? Should this be slower? Do you want to hear more violin here or do you want to hear more clarinet? Maestro.
And are they allowed to assert
and
that
the composer,
type of control?
Well, the composer
is... Of course
is
you want to defer to the person who created the work.
Yeah.
We serve the composer. That is really, if we're interpreting music, if it's from a composer who is no longer with us or from centuries ago, we can only go by what's in the score, what they've written in their letters, what other people have written about
how they
practice
interpreted
of
their
interpretation.
But those who are like, so what's the sort of riskiest thing either that you've commissioned here in Portland or Jennifer that you've been asked to play here or elsewhere?
Well,
come on, you're going to make news here on
Outlook Portland. You know, composers through the ages have used the idiom of chamber music frequently to perform in their own works. Mozart used to play viola or piano in his own chamber music. Brahms would play the piano. Dvorak would play the viola. Sometimes we have composers playing their own works. This coming week at Chamber Music Northwest, we're doing a new work by flutist Valerie Coleman, who's the flutist with the Imani Wind Quintet, and they're doing a big work for the five winds and four strings at the same time with a Miami quartet. Or are they playing it with the Orion Quartet? We have two great quartets in residence.
Does it make you nervous when it's something new?
Well,
sure, because you don't know what you're going to get.
But in this case, we have
it's exciting, though.
The chance to see and hear the creator of this music performing and working with other musicians.
Well, that's one of the great things about this festival is that people from around the country who are great artists elsewhere come here and do that. Here in Portland at Reed College and Catlin Gable.
But to get back to the issue of working with a live composer, I think what's really interesting about it for me has been, of course, to have that reference there. It takes the guesswork out of, you know, what did he or she mean when he wrote this? It really doesn't make sense. But I think when we're trained as classical musicians, we're trained to teach the score as kind of a Bible. And, you know, you think if there's a tempo marking, it says you're supposed to play it like this, this fast, you're supposed mm-hmm. to play it that fast. But you find when you work with living composers that what they've written in the score, it depends on the composer, of course, but often what they've written is really just guidelines, not that you can change the notes or do whatever you want, but I'm sure you've had the same experience that you play something quite a bit faster, quite a bit slower, for example, than what they've indicated in the score, and the composer will say, actually, I like that better. And
sure.
Or you play something with much more freedom than how it's actually written, or vice versa, and the composer will say, actually, I really like what you're doing.
So you've even elaborated on it.
Yeah, it's not exactly what I wrote, but I really enjoy what you're doing. And that makes you realize, of course, when you're going back interpreting Mozart and Beethoven, that there is quite a bit of freedom to, it's not, you know, something that's really calcified into the score.
So but it does evolve over time.
And that, yeah,
musical notation has severe limitations, as do words. I could say David Bragdon or David Bragdon, yet the letters on the page are the same. It's the same thing with musical notation. The notes are the same, but two musicians might take those same notes and play them in a vastly different way with different kind of expression. When the composer is there, then they can at least arbitrate how it should
be pronounced. Well, I'm going to give that a try because we're going to take a break here and we'll come back and talk about the expectations of the classical music audience here in Portland, but I'm going to give it a try. This is David Bragdon on Outlook Portland, taking a break.
Outlook Portland will continue in a moment.